The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome to worship this morning. Consideration of and care for those in need is an essential component of stewardship. It is the sharing of wealth, in the sharing of wealth, that we avoid the snare of wealth. It is the one whom death could not hold, who comes to us risen from the dead, who can free us from the death grip of greed. There's good news in the scriptures we will hear today. Good news for those who are really free, or for those who long to be really free. Let us worship together.
join me in the call to worship. Jesus Christ is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Jesus Christ, who rules over all things, gathers us in love. Jesus Christ is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Let us offer our praise and thanksgiving. Let us pray. Eternal God, help us to measure our time in faithful generosity, that your will may be done, your kingdom come, for life everlasting. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like one day. The Lord is not slow about this promise, as some think of slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. Trusting in God's grace and mercy, let us confess our sins together. Please pray with me. God of justice and righteousness, you lift up the lowly and fill the empty. Yet we adore the high and the mighty. You reach out to the poor, yet we ceaselessly pursue wealth. You talk about treasure in heaven, yet we want dollars in our accounts right now. Correct our misguided ways. Forgive our lack of generosity. Free us from striving for more and more. Change our hearts so that we can tend to things that matter and find our life in Jesus Christ. Amen. Without regard for the cost, the precious love of God is poured out in Jesus Christ. This is good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Oh, Please be seated. Let us pray. God of the prophets, by the power of the Holy Spirit, speak your word to us and seal it within us so that we may heed your call. Amen. The first reading is from the 32nd chapter of Jeremiah. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord in the 10th year of King Zedekiah of Judah, which was the 18th year of Nebuchadnezzar. At that time, the army of the king of Babylon was besieging Jerusalem, and the prophet Jeremiah was confined in the court of the guard that was in the palace of the king of Judah, where King Zedekiah of Judah had confined him. Zedekiah had said, "Why do you prophesy and say, 'Thus says the Lord, I am going to give this city into the hand of the king of Babylon, and he shall take it?'" Jeremiah said, "The word of the Lord came to me. Hanamel, son of your uncle Shallum, is going to come to you and say, 'Buy my field that is at Anathoth, for the right of redemption by purchase is yours.'" Then my cousin Hanamel came to me in the court of the guard, in accordance with the word of the Lord, and said to me, "Buy my field that is at Anathoth in the land of Benjamin, for the right of possession and redemption is yours. Buy it for yourself." Then I knew that this was the word of the Lord. And I bought the field at Anathoth from my cousin Hanamel, and weighed out the money to him, 17 shekels of silver. I signed the deed, sealed it, got witnesses, and weighed the money on scales. Then I took the sealed deed of purchase containing the terms and conditions and the open copy, and I gave my deed of purchase to Baruch, son of Neriah, son of Messiah, in the presence of my cousin Hanamel, in the presence of the witnesses who signed the deed of purchase, and in the presence of all the Judeans who were sitting in the court of the guard. In their presence, I charged Baruch, saying, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, take these deeds, both this sealed deed of purchase and this open deed, and put them in an earthenware jar in order that they may last for a long time. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, houses and fields and vineyards shall again be bought in this land." The second reading is from 1 Timothy, the 6th chapter. "Of course, there is great gain in godliness combined with contentment. For we brought nothing into the world, so we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with these. But those who want to be rich fall into temptation and are trapped by many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. And in their eagerness to be rich, some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pains. But as for you, man of God, shun all this. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of eternal life, to which you were called, and for which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. In the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Jesus Christ, who in his testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession, I charge you to keep the commandment without spot or blame until the manifestation of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will bring about at the right time. He who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords. It is he alone who has immortality and dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see, To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. As for those who in this present age are rich, command them not to be haughty or to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but rather on God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, generous and ready to share, thus storing up for themselves the treasure of a good foundation for the future, that they may take hold of the life that really is life. This is the word of the Lord.
And all God's people said, Amen. The gospel reading today comes from the gospel according to Luke, chapter 16, verses 19 through 31. Luke tells us, there was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen, and who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who longed to satisfy his hunger with what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs would come and lick his sores. The poor man died and was carried away by the angels to be with Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried. in Hades, where he was being tormented, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. He called out, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in agony in these flames." But Abraham said, "Child, remember that during your lifetime you received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner evil things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. Besides all this, between you and us, a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who might want to pass from here to you cannot do so, and no one can cross from there to us." He said, "Then, Father, I beg you to send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may warn them, so that they will not also come to this place of torment." Abraham replied, "They have Moses and the prophets. They should listen to them." He said, "No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent." He said to him, "If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Pope Francis sure seems to have a knack for making headlines, and not in the bad variety, but good headlines. Whether it's refusing to live in the papal palace or driving a 1984 Renault that was given to him, or cold calling people who are suffering in some way, or calling his denomination to focus much less on hot button issues, this pope is serving in such a way that we haven't seen in a long time. I think it helps us to know that he is a Jesuit, the first Jesuit pope. Jesuits, or the Society of Jesus, were formed by Ignatius Loyola in 1534. They are committed to evangelism and education, and one of the vows they take is a vow to poverty. Franciscans are not the only ones to do that. Jesuits love learning. A Jesuit, a Dominican, and a Franciscan were walking along an old road debating the greatness of their orders. Suddenly, an apparition of the Holy Family appeared in front of them, with Jesus in a manger and Mary and Joseph praying over him. The Franciscan fell on his face, overcome in awe at the sight of God being born into poverty. The Dominican fell on his knees, adoring the beautiful reflection of the Trinity in the Holy Family. The Jesuit walked up to Joseph, put his arm around his shoulder, and said, "So, have you thought about where to send the boy to school?" That's the Jesuits, lovers of learning. Pope Francis is cut from that same cloth, and it is very clear that he is quite happy to think for himself. All the religious orders share this kind of rivalry. Benedictines, Carmelites, Jesuits, Franciscans all relish telling good jokes about each other. And one of the jokes about the Franciscans says that they are an order that set out to do good, and they ended up doing well. Not even Jesus knows how much money the Franciscans have. So the rich man in our parable for today may have been similar. No one knew how much money he had. All that was known was that he had tons of it. And although he was obviously no Franciscan and setting out to do good, he did at least share the crumbs from his table with poor Lazarus. You have to give the rich man at least credit for that. What the rich man came to realize is that sharing crumbs ain't enough. This discovery is part of what he wanted to pass on to his five brothers so that they would do better. But there's something else I want to have us understand this morning. The parable we have before us about the rich man and Lazarus can be read as a story about the importance of seeing. Specifically, the rich man provides us with the example of how wealth can curtain the windows of our hearts and minds. Wealth can cause blindness. And the things that wealth blinds us to are the very things that we need to see. In the last month or so, we've been hearing quite a lot from Luke about material possessions and wealth. In the parable of the rich fool, we saw how wealth can be deceptive. The fool, you may remember, had an exceptionally good year, and he said, "What am I to do? I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. I'll eat, drink, and take my ease, for I have much laid up for the future." He thought he had it made. He was set forever. But that night, he was told that his soul would be required of him. And he died. And God said to him, "Whose will all this wealth be?" The fool was deceived because he believed that his wealth carried with it some kind of security. He discovered that wealth offers no ultimate security. In other parables and events, we've heard how Jesus' teachings about the potential of making an idol out of wealth and about the importance of seeing to the needs of the poor and the importance of giving to others in a righteous manner. In our giving, we should not seek to draw attention to ourselves, and we should not give in a way that belittles the poor. And today, we reach the pinnacle of these teachings in the parable of the rich man and Lazarus. So for more than a month now, the gospel lessons have focused on wealth. Why? Why all of this concern about material possessions? Well, some argue that it had to do with the nature of Luke's church. The community to which Luke wrote was either made up predominantly of wealthy people who needed to be reminded of their obligations to the poor, or the community was about evenly divided between the rich and the poor, and that imbalance was creating tensions within the community. No one knows exactly for sure. What is clear for us are the implications of Jesus' teachings. At the heart of the gospel is the great reversal. The people who were not the people of God become the people of God. Nobodies become somebodies. The old is made new. The first become last. The last become first. The rich and the powerful, who so often see no need even of God's grace, are cut off from the people of God, while the poor, the lowly, and the outcasts are given a proper place within the household of faith. The promise and the challenge of the gospel is that God reverses social and economic realities in surprising ways. Nowhere is this reversal seen more vividly than in this parable of the rich man and Lazarus. So there are two themes that I'd like to develop this morning. The first one dominates from the very beginning, the changed circumstances of the primary characters. The contrast between them could not be more sharply drawn. The rich man is very rich. Lazarus is expendable. The rich man, dressed in purple, had a huge wardrobe, more clothes than Jennifer Lopez, more shoes than the Kardashians, and feasts, sumptuous feasts, extravagant feasts, every day. The portrait is one of a man who is fabulously wealthy, who enjoys nothing more than conspicuously displaying that wealth. And then there is Lazarus, and he is described in very ugly terms, terms we would rather not hear. He's covered with sores. Who knows how well he could get around? Likely not well. As for clothes, he likely wore a bare minimum of rags. As for food, he is hungry. He longs for nothing more than to fill himself with the crumbs that fall from the rich man's table. At that time, there were no things like napkins that we have today. The custom instead was to wipe your hands with something like pita bread, which was then discarded. That was what Lazarus longed to have, those scraps of bread that the rich man used to wipe his hands. The dogs lick his sores, and that tells us that he is religiously unclean. Lazarus is an outcast. Jesus tells us that they both die, and it's only after the death of each and the great reversal that we begin to understand the rich man's problem. So let us be clear how the rich man is described. He is not harshly condemned, as if there was something inherently wrong with having money. Remember, Timothy said it's the love of money that is the root of all evil. We're not told that the rich man persecuted Lazarus, that he refused to give him those scraps that fell from his table. He didn't try to have him shooed away from the gate. The clue to the rich man's problem is in verse 23. It is in that verse, after they both have died, that the rich man sees Lazarus for the first time. While both were living, while Lazarus languished and suffered at the rich man's gate, it seems the rich man never saw him. It's not that he didn't acknowledge him. He never saw him. This vividly portrays one danger of wealth. Wealth can cause blindness. It seems that the rich man's wealth, his sumptuous lifestyle, so distorts his vision that he's unable to perceive the plight of Lazarus. He's unable to identify with his predicament. He's unable to appreciate his suffering. The rich man is blind to the humanity of Lazarus. He doesn't see him. And that is what wealth can do to you. Prosperity has a way of limiting our perspective, of closing the shades of what is distasteful to us so that we are not disturbed. Wealth puts walls and gates around houses in our hearts and in our minds. That is why the great preacher of the early church, John Chrysostom, proclaimed, "If you cannot find Christ in the beggar, you will not find him in the chalice." Thanks for that, Cedar. And so the great reversal happens. As the rich man calls out from Hades to Father Abraham, we are reminded of how John the Baptist instructed the crowds not to claim Abraham as father so easily. One wonders if the rich man ever called on Father Abraham while he was alive. Now, all of the pleas of the rich man are resisted. So thoroughly has his wealth curtained his vision that even in his torment, he sees Lazarus as little more than a messenger boy who can be sent to run an errand. He still doesn't see him as a brother, as kin. Sadly, it seems the rich man is beyond repentance, and Lazarus is in the embrace of Abraham, enjoying the comforts that he never had in life. It's at this point that we find the other theme that I want to lift up. The rich man asked Abraham to send Lazarus back to his brothers to warn them about what has happened. His request is denied. It's denied because his brothers already have the teachings of Moses and the prophets. They already have all that they need to know, all that they need to guide them in living in a way that will save them from the torment that the rich man is suffering. The scriptures are central, more important than some miracle we might see, more important than someone even who comes back from the dead. What Luke would have us understand is that all of these scriptures are fulfilled in Jesus. These scriptures are filled with instructions on how those who have much are to care for those who have little. And Jesus embodied these teachings in his life, for he was someone who was rich and who became poor so that we might have life. So Abraham tells the rich man that if his brothers will not listen to Moses and the prophets, then they will not listen to anything, even to miracles. A very real link then is established between Moses and the prophets and Jesus and the church. We are part of that witness. People should be able to look to us and to understand. They should be able to look to us and see that we are a community who cares about the poor. We are a community who really sees the poor and who welcomes them and cares for them and advocates for them. We are the community of the great reversals. With our lives, we are to show that we really see. And many of us do that week in and week out. Our deacons do that through our blessing bags and the book collection and in many other ways. Our thrift shop was established to demonstrate how we see. And our support of mission endeavors, both locally and internationally, bear witness to the fact that we have heard Moses and the prophets and Jesus. For many in our society, this may be a hard parable. So much of what we have heard from Jesus in recent weeks has been challenging. What makes this parable hard, with either the rich man and the Lazarus being not so identifiable with us. None of us are fabulously rich like the rich man. None of us are destitute like Lazarus. So how then can this parable speak to us? Maybe it can speak to us through the five brothers. Maybe we can identify ourselves with them. Like them, none of us have died yet. So maybe, like the brothers, there's still time for us. Time to understand what the rich man would have us know. The rich man would want us to see, to really see, even those at our gates who we might no longer see as human beings. Can we see the poor as people and not as the immunocompromised or drunks or drug addicts or criminals or the homeless or mentally ill or whatever condition. Do we really see them as people? To all of us, the rich man says, open your eyes while there is still time. And one more thing, you probably will want to share more than crumbs. We should hear what Timothy heard. Do good and stop worrying about doing well. Amen. I invite you to stand with me now as we affirm our faith by way of this passage from the Accra Confession. We believe in God, creator and sustainer of all life, who calls us as partners in the creation and redemption of the world. We live under the promise that Jesus Christ came so that all might have life in fullness. Guided and upheld by the Holy Spirit, we open ourselves to the reality of our world. We believe that any economy of the household of life, given to us by God's covenant to sustain life, is accountable to God. We believe the economy exists to serve the dignity and well-being of people in community within the bounds of the sustainability of creation. We believe that human beings are called to choose God over mammon, and that confessing our faith is an act of obedience. We believe that we are called in the Spirit to account for the hope that is within us through Jesus Christ, and believe that justice shall prevail and peace shall reign. Amen. Our hymn now is number 712. Let us sing together. Be seated. As we go to God together in prayer now, some of those we'll want to remember are listed in the bulletin. Iris asks that we remember Josiah, especially this week. He's going to have a test or procedure done that will hopefully show that he is ready to come off of the ventilator. Let's pray for Marilyn Dewey and Kathy Troy's sister Diane, Berta Wendell, Beth Chado, Ann Mast Catton, Mike Kelly, and Barb Schleicher. It's good to see you. I'm hoping you're continuing to do well, and let us remember the Charlos too. Joe Cochran asks that we remember her too in our prayers. She's going to be having a couple of tests this week, and we pray that the news will be good for her. Are there others that we can remember in our prayers today? Yes, Bob. Let us remember Jack and Ruth. Are there others? I'm sorry. Yes, Cindy. Amen. Yeah, let us remember Nani. Any others?
We also have
Oh, yes. Hi, Beth. Good to see you. We're still going to pray for you, though. Well, mindful of these, then, let us go to God together in prayer, first in silence to offer our own intercessions and petitions, and then as we pray, let us pray. As scattered grains of wheat are gathered together into one loaf, so let us gather our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of God's good creation as we say together, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. O God, rich in mercy, fill your church with righteousness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Empower the baptized by your Spirit to be rich in good works and ready to share. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Protect the earth and its creatures. Provide water, food, shelter, and favorable habitats, especially for endangered species. Preserve the threatened ice caps, glaciers, parks, and beaches. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Increase justice in nations, local governments, and courtrooms. Guide lawyers and those who hold public office to act with compassion and discernment. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Give food to the hungry. Set the captives free. Lift up those who are bowed down. Watch over the stranger. Tend to those who are ill or suffering, especially those we have named today. Protect those under the threat of hurricanes and sustain those who are recovering in Canada, Alaska, Japan, and Puerto Rico. Stir us to act in the best interest of our neighbors. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Enliven our praise. Inspire musicians, artists, poets, and all who create beauty in this place. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Enfold the saints who have died in the arms of your loving care. Grant that the holy angels accompany us and bring us to eternal life with them in the light of your presence. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Gather together in the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, gracious God, we offer these and all our prayers to you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The psalmist declares that the earth is the Lord's and all that is in it. Mindful of God's goodness and grace, let us now return a portion of all that we have for the building up of God's kingdom in the world. You may do so as the usher passes this morning, or you may continue to send in your contributions through the mail or use the donate button on the church's website. Let us give.
Thank you. life to all things and richly provides us with everything. Use these, our offerings, to take hold of and show us the life that really is. Amen. And let us pray together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
It is good to see you all on this first Sunday of autumn, and what a gorgeous day it is. Before we go out to enjoy it, I call your attention to a few of the announcements in the bulletin. Coming up on Saturday is our celebration of Pride Fest in our community. It's our, I think, the sixth year that we've done this, sixth or the seventh year. So it'll start on Friday afternoon at 5 o'clock. If you'd like to come and help decorate the Green Street side of the church, you can meet me and Cindy and others here to help do that. And then on Saturday from noon to four, we'll have a booth set up at the vendor area at the intersection of Race and Main Street, just like last year. And then some might walk in the parade. We're going to have fewer this year to do that because some are going to be traveling next weekend. But if you'd like to do that, you're welcome to. And Cindy would like to show you something that you can have. Yep. All right.
The other thing is I have a postcard for the postcard.
Yeah, so you'll remember her moment for mission last week about reproductive rights and how there are pieces of legislation before our state legislature. You can add your voice to that conversation. She has the postcards to help you do that. And thank you for displaying the shirt. The people who made that for us liked it so much that they have it displayed in their window now where their business is. So you'll want one of those. See Cindy about that. On Sunday, then, a week from today, we're going to be hosting Crop Walk. So if you'd like to help with that, Robert is here, or Jason, you can see him and let him know that you'd like to help. We need a handful of people to help welcome walkers. We're going to have a couple of tables set up so that those who are going to register people can do that. And if you'd like to be here to help with that, plan to be here around 1:30 or so next Sunday. Yep, very good. Thank you. Blessing of the Animal Service is coming up. You may remember that. We had a beautiful day for that last year. We're going to be doing that again on October the 9th. And then please note the announcement from our thrift shop about the winter clothes request. If you have things you'd like to pass on or share, the details in the announcement tell you how you might do that. So I know with me, you thank Karen for once again leading us in worship. Thank you to Seungah and to Camille for lifting us in song, and to our choir. Thank you to our section leaders. And thank you to Cedar and Brett and Jamie for ushering this morning. So as you go forth now, go forth in the power of the Holy Spirit to love and serve the Lord in all that you do. Would you bow for the benediction? Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May God's face smile upon you and be gracious unto you. May God give you grace never to sell yourself short, grace to risk something big for something good, grace to remember that the world is now too dangerous for anything but truth and too small for anything but love. So may God take your minds and think through them. May God take your lips and speak through them. May God take your hearts and set them on fire. Through Jesus, our Savior. Amen.